October 17 is a suspenseful day for the U.S. 1st Cavalrymen as they advance into the outskirts of Pyongyang, capital city of North Korea. The city is known to be heavily fortified, and it is expected that the Reds will make a death stand for their capital. It is reported that the Reds have 30,000 men defending Pyongyang. Another Red is added to the 75,000 captured so far. A vehicle burns beside the road. Ammunition explodes in the fire. The attack is led by tanks as the 1st Cavalry advances under fire toward the center of the city. The railroad guides them. Then, surprisingly, the enemy fire weakens as U.S. infantrymen reach the heart of the city. The Reds are withdrawing. Although there is occasional rear guard fire and sniper activity, the main Red force has begun to flee northward in disorganization. A company medic gives first aid to a cavalryman wounded in the street fighting. As the 1st Cavalrymen overrun the city, South Korean troops join them. The ROK forces met heavy resistance on the east side of town, but finally fought their way through after 6 hours. They're following the retreating enemy northward. An estimated Red force of 30,000 is now fleeing Pyongyang. South Koreans and 1st Cavalrymen join forces, decide their zones of action, and move on. In the eastern area of Pyongyang, near the Taedong River, the South Koreans encounter a pocket of enemy rear guard troops and pause to wipe them out. Only small arms fire is necessary as the river is crossed by bridge and assault boats. As UN forces take over the city, the North Korean communist government has vanished, presumably having fled north across the Manchurian border. Heavily fortified capital of Korean communism is now under the United Nations flag. As UN forces take the North Korean capital at Pyongyang, a new threat to the Reds gets underway at Kimpo Airfield. Paratroopers of the 187th Airborne Regiment plan to jump ahead of the Reds fleeing Pyongyang, cutting off their escape route to the border. The planes are C-47 transports and C-119 boxcars. There are over 4,000 men in this operation, which consists of two separate drops on 20 and 21 October. The destination is a point 33 miles north of Pyongyang, where the Reds are fleeing through the towns of Sukchon and Suncheon. Here they go. The paratroopers bail out in waves from a dozen planes at a time. On the ground, there is practically no opposition. The attack comes as a complete surprise. Watching the jump is General MacArthur, who flew here from Japan to observe this first airborne operation of the Korean War. Flying over the attack area in his Constellation, the United Nations commander stated, "This closes the trap on the enemy." Of particular interest in this drop is the parachuting of heavy equipment, vehicles and artillery. The equipment drop takes place 10 minutes after the personnel have landed. Most of the material lands without damage, and the paratroopers rush out to put it into action. Transportation found available on the scene is pressed into service. Although the big jump was delayed at the start by bad weather, it moves like clockwork once it gets underway. Casualties are few. Out of the 4,064 men who made the two jumps, only 90 men are listed as jump casualties, and most of these consist of broken legs and sprains. Evacuation is rapid. Specially equipped helicopters land to carry the wounded, and they are quickly on their way back to the hospitals. Shortly after the paratroopers take their positions, they are joined by tanks of the 1st Cavalry Division, which have pushed through from Pyongyang. As these forces join, the last remnants of the Red Army are compressed into an area only 50 miles from the Manchurian border.